Hello everyone, how are you today? So this is the fifth episode of Aaron Talks. I am Mihai from Trust Taking, and in this episode we'll cover the security and the IoT industry. So we are trying to explain how the blockchain could be a link between these two. Right now we think this is a missing part. Before starting the discussion, I wanna talk a bit about Aaron Talks. Aaron Talks is a open it's an open community live stream. We're inviting every week a new partner and streaming it on their channel, and we're trying to educate our communities about what's Aaron, what's trying to solve, and all the tech part from the blockchain industry and also outside the blockchain industry, as blockchain should be adopted by real people and companies outside of the crypto space. So today I have the pleasure to discuss about the security topic with Marius from MG Staking. His background is in security industry, and he could help us to understand a bit better how the security it's a good mix with blockchain and how we can use these two together with IoT. So let me invite Marius to introduce himself and tell us a bit about his background, about MG Staking, and how he see this industry. So Marius, please.
Hello everyone. I hope you can hear me. So I'm Marius. I'm the founder of the MG Staking, and I'm very happy to be here today with Mihai from Trust Taking. My pleasure, Mihai, and thank you for the invitation. So basically, at my root, I'm a software engineer with background in security, as Mihai said, working for almost 11 years on the embedded side. I finished my university studies here in Bucharest in 2010. Just after that, after 2 years, I made a security master thesis with different thesis there. Starting with 2010, I worked for NXP Freescale at that time on different embedded areas. That's about, let's say, my background. Right now I'm working mostly with different chips and architectures here at NXP, mostly on IDTMX side and with the different crypto accelerators, covering also stuff like secure element for Ledger and different co-processors. My first interaction with blockchain and this kind of let's say technology started initially during my master in 2012, when my teacher told us about Bitcoin and blockchain. We studied a bit about it, but let's say it was not very catchy, to be honest, at that very point. It was mostly like, hey, okay, another like money. Money bits or something like that, and was not very interested, to be honest. And after that was basically a break for me. Last year in June, following a very popular podcast here in Bucharest, I heard about the Elrond project. And yeah, to be honest with you guys, for me it was very catchy, the first interview I saw with Beniamin Minko. And I said, okay, let's try to understand more. Let's try to study the white paper, to know the team, to see more and more what's happening there. And this was basically my first interaction with Elrond. I stayed more or less a couple of hours, good hours, on their Telegram groups in the first month. After that, maybe you know most of the you from the Romanian, let's say, communities. I became an admin on most of the Telegram groups for Elrond. And a couple of months ago, I think first in March or in February this year, I had the big pleasure to meet the team in Sibiu. Was a very interesting meeting there, and was really, really fascinating to meet the guys. And I think after more discussions with the guys, knowing the validators and being appropriate with also with the validators team, I tried to understand more and more the technology. And I said, hey, why not? Let's maybe start to become a validator. And yeah, this was basically my starting with the validating part, let's say. So I'm not part of the, let's say, validator communities from the beginning. I was pretty late in the game, but I tried to be a quick learner and yeah, to learn more and more about the Elrond blockchain, the deep inside, and about the technology and how to become a good validator. And just after that, just very close to phase three, I started with the idea, hey, maybe it's okay to have also a staking provider, a company for Elrond. I discussed with some good friends and colleagues from the Elrond community admins, and I said, okay, let's try to be together in this one. And I started to build around MG staking.
That's perfect, Maris. That's a great introduction and about your background and about how you started with Elrond. And we know that you are very active on all groups over the place, everywhere you are there. Also your colleagues from MG Staking. So yeah, glad to have you with Elrond. So cool. Let's start our chat about security and IoT. I know that you are working for your company in this industry. And I want to start talking about Ledger. We know that Ledger is the most important part for a crypto user. So it's the most secure way to store your money, your tokens,
yep.
Even if it's Bitcoin, e-gold, Ethereum, and something else. Ledger is the device you really need to have. Can you explain a bit why? What's the secure element of the Ledger? How is this working? And after that, if it's too techy for our viewers, we will try to give real examples comparing JSON wallet with a Ledger.
Sure.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, that's a great question, Mihai. Sure. So, as you maybe already know from our communities, guys, we will always mention about Ledger, and we will suggest you to keep your private keys into the Ledger. So, every wallet, here specifically for the Elrond wallet, you know, you have that the pair keys, a public key and a private key. The public key, as the name is public. You can share it, and it's basically the wallet name. It's that one with ERD one and so on. And the private one is basically the most important key. You need to keep it very securely, very privately, because with that key you need to sign transactions. Let's say code, data, and text information if you want. Okay, that private key, it's very, very important. And I always said, security without a bit more or less hardware security is not so reliable. So that's why you need to have like a coprocessor or a secure memory or something, let's say, very reliable in terms of security, unbreakable, which only on the hardware side can be reached. If you want, Ledger is basically like an USB stick, a very small memory or a very small device, but the key part, the key or the magic of the security inside of it is that secure element, which can be seen like a coprocessor. Okay. It's like a very, very small chip with a dedicated secure memory, which can keep inside in a very reliable and in a very secure way your private key. That private key is used only internally in that secure memory. It's never exposed outside of the bus. It's never exposed, no matter what is happening with that secure element, with that ledger. And all your transactions are signed and are encrypted or decrypted inside of that secure element. So if you want, it's like a encapsulated device with some special secure functions, which are never exposed outside of the chip. So on the bus, you see only encrypted bits, encrypted data, and it's basically impossible to recover the private key in plain text key only from those data or those bits. This is on the story.
I think I was on mute. Let me start.
No, I was here.
I was on the live. So yeah, we started to talk, guys, about the Ledger and how this is a real deal for the crypto community. So comparing Ledger with a JSON is very important, because a Ledger is not able to be break from an external source like a hacker or maybe a bad website, right? So why I think JSON is not that good is because in this world we have malwares on Windows or Mac, and also bad websites and hackers which are cloning the Elrond website and different wallets, right? So if you store your JSON file on the desktop and you don't know that you have a malware, someone could steal it from you, right? And also have a keylogger, which is tracking your keys, they will get your password easily, right? So basically, at that point, they access your wallet, right? That's how this works. How is Ledger protecting this?
Yeah, right? So basically, as you said, Mihai, what is the JSON file basically is your private key encrypted with a key derivative from the password. So if a hacker knows only the JSON or only the password, you are still safe. But as you mentioned above, if you are losing both in the hacker hands, you are compromised in that moment.
Even they have just a file, they could try to break the password with brute force.
Yeah, to brute force if your password is very weak.
Yeah, so if your password is less than 12 characters, in less than a year, they can break it without getting it. So why you need a Ledger? Because when you upload, when you connect your Ledger to the Elrond wallet, for example, and you try to sign something, the transaction is not signed directly. You first receive the transaction in your device, so it's
correct.
Externally, it's offline, right?
You can, and all the magic.
Yeah, it's and all the magic of the secure element you describe, it's happening there just after you confirm that. Right, so you have time to read, you have time to confirm that you sent that amount of money to that wallet with this fee and with that data. And once you are sure, you press confirm, the secure element is asking internally for the private key and signing the transaction. Once it's signed, it's sent back to the Elrond wallet. So as you can see, even if you have a malware in this case, no one is able to get your private keys or sign the transaction for you remotely, because they don't have the real device, right?
Mm-hmm. That's really, really correct.
So that's the point.
Yeah, so basically what our the guys from community need to understand is that all the magic for the Ledger, it's happening only inside of the secure element. Your private keys are never exposed what data you are trying to do. If you are going more and more trying to deep dive in terms of security, and you are trying to tampering this device with, let's say, very expensive equipment and with a special, let's say, laboratory, you can trying to make some reverse engineering and trying to see the voltage around the secure element, but for that you need to have real expensive secure reverse engineering equipment, which is not, let's say, very cheap. And secondly, will not be, let's say, a cold wallet in that moment. Somebody will try to reverse engineer, will try to open the device, will try to connect all the voltage pins to some special equipment. So for the normal case, for the normal users, you are 100% safe using a ledger. It's no problem, really.
Interesting question, and I would like to know your opinion on that. What's your opinion about password managers in browsers? Do you think they are safe to store your passwords?
My opinion, no. My personal opinion, no. There are some, let's say, very popular from different companies. I don't want to mention here. But I'm not using any kind of these password keeper managers,
what
something like that.
What could be the security breach there? Like, what could go wrong?
You never know what is behind. My logic is, if I don't know the magic behind a security feature, I'm not using it. I'm trying to understand before to be 100% sure what's happening there. You never know what can be happening. Maybe I don't know, security leak, a cloud problem. I don't know. It can be a lot of problems there.
Yeah.
Maybe you know, Mihai, a couple of months ago, Chrome announced that they had some problems with keeping the private passwords safe into the Chrome side.
Yeah.
And it was a serious security breach. So yeah, personally, I don't recommend to use a security password manager. But no. Everybody, it's free to choose whatever they want. But personally, I don't recommend this kind of.
My recommendation is the same. Managers. If it's somewhere stored in the cloud, even if it's, I don't know, with Google, you don't know what they are doing there. So I use it for some passwords, and they have a real interesting function, which is kind of like scanning your passwords for data leaks from other, other hackers' database full of passwords. So if they are searching for your password in other database, they are exposing your hash of the password, right? So if that's if that's going out of the internet or out of the Google hands, someone could get the hashes of the password from Google and try to decode or compare with extant hashes. So that's going to, crack your password later on.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
that's why I don't like it. We also have a question. How do we store our passwords?
That's a very good question. Yeah, I can say about my personal example. Usually I have a local document, a text one, which is encrypted, and there I put all my passwords. And also my hardware is my local HDD, my local hard drive is encrypted.
Yeah, also another question is there any hardware wallet which is working with a mobile, like to connect your Ledger, for example, with a mobile phone? I believe that Ledger is working with Android, like I tested it and it's working.
Yeah.
But
I think only with micro USB cable, not directly via Bluetooth. I think the next generation will support SOLTRON to connect via Bluetooth. But right now, yes, it's possible to connect Ledger using a USB browser. Sorry, a USB cable and your Android phone.
Yeah, that's very interesting. So let's start touching on IoT and blockchain. How do you see this IoT industry? What's missing from IoT right now? We know that IoT is very secure at the processor level, right? As a Ledger, it's very secure. But how they send the data between devices, do you think that's secure? Do you think they can improve that and scale that?
Yeah, that's a great question, Mihai. So maybe it's okay to have a small introduction about IoT. What is IoT? So IoT is basically is referring to Internet of Things, a lot of systems which are interconnected and able to transfer data and to communicate with each other over networking. This is, let's say, the simple definition, and all this without human intervention. The personal or businesses, let's say, related here are endless. We can handle a lot of devices, starting with, let's say, smart homes, smart devices, and everything, let's say, ubiquitous computing around us, and finishing with automotive, connected cars, connected objects around the cars, and finishing with different robots and industrial things. As you mentioned, very good mention from Mihai. Everything we have right now around security, specifically for IoT, is very well secured on the edge side. The edge side means every chip, every device, every end device is pretty well connected and pretty well secured. We have different coprocessors, as we have secure element for the ledger. We have different mechanisms to protect the end node. And this is basically, if you want, the microservices or the micro security services level at the edge level. But what's missing right now in this big picture is the macro security level. So when we discuss about interconnection processing level and all this kind of security stack, which is interconnecting all these devices, it's a bit breakable, more or less, more I think in this context. So this interoperability from security point of view, it's a bit breakable, in my opinion.
How do you see blockchain helping them with that?
Blockchain for sure can accelerate and can improve a lot the security around IoT, because first of all, is decentralized, right? And secondly, it's a problem of resources in trying to break all this kind of security layer. You know, guys, we have a lot of devices interconnected to form all this IoT. We have millions of devices, and these are growing exponentially in the next 20 years. So, you know, blockchain is basically supplying here the Byzantine problem, right? In order to trying to break the entire system, you need more than to have more than half of the systems corrupted by you in order to try to break something. So for sure, it's impossible to incorporate more than half in order to destroy the system. So for sure, this will be very, very secure when you discuss about interoperability and communication interprocesses.
Let's try to give some real examples how we think, because we talk about this a lot in past, and how we see from our perspective blockchain helping the IoT industry, also the cars industry. For example, when Tesla will send an update to all cars in the same time, how they are preventing the fake chips or probably fake cars trying to be like a Tesla connected to the Tesla server. There is no signed mechanism, right? You said something about how they know that the CPU of the Tesla is the real one. Sure, they are saving that ID somewhere, but someone could clone that as well, right? There should be a signing mechanism as a ledger inside of the car, right?
Correct. Very good approach. Indeed, from what we studied around secure over there updates, this is basically the most used mechanism in order to update your software car. For sure, that package is signed and encrypted by the provider, in this case by Tesla. That the tricky point is that initial handshake between the server and the client. For sure, we can send an encrypted and signed package to the car, but the question is how we can know that that car is not a hacked one and the chip from that car is not a clone one, or maybe it's a legitimate or not or trustable by the provider. So this question is very, very important because that update is pretty critical and can contain some critical and very sensitive data and it's not okay to be in the hands of a hacker, right? Because, okay, even if it's encrypted, you can try to reverse engineering, try to break it, and after just a matter of time, after you get the sensitive data. So indeed, using blockchain here, you can have what we are calling a manufacturing protection mechanism, and you can't know for sure that chip inside of the car is legitimate, is trustable, and you can't know, and you can find out also using some special security features like fuses and so on. You can know the provider of the chip is trustable, and if you have a partnership with that manufacturer car and so on. So yeah, this is a great example how blockchain can be used for secure over-the-air updates and how can improve this secure handshake and secure flow.
Yeah, also I think they can use that secure element in other ways. Like, let's say that car is a big ledger, right? With a secret key and a public key and so on. So let's give a real example based on a service story. You know that when you go to a service, the guy from the service is telling you that, hey, your car had more kilometers on board, right? But someone changed the kilometers from 1,000 to 100. They are not storing this information in blockchain. If they will store this in blockchain, like a black box in a plane, right? If they store that, everyone will be able to see that that car had this many kilometers at this date. So no one can change that in a lower amount of kilometers. So this is one I can see. And the second one is for smart cars like Tesla. When recently they had a fire incident somewhere in California, right? And they had a debate about was that car driving with AI or the car was in hand of the customer. So they couldn't prove that. But I guess with a blockchain system as Elrond, they could send information every 10 seconds or a minute, let's say, all size of the car to the blockchain. And that will be intercepted in 6 seconds, the latency of Elrond, back to the servers of Tesla, right? So they could show instantly after the accident the entire report of that car, like what was happening in that time range, right?
Perfect, yeah.
And this could be applied as well to planes, because you know the story when they are trying to recover the black box, they are looking for it. I don't know if it's still this process, but I know that there is still a black box in the plane and they need to recover that to see what the pilot did in the past fly. So if they will be able to send the information to the blockchain directly, will be again immutable and instantly accessible to everyone to check the fly. So why they are not doing this yet, we don't know. Probably because they haven't met Benjamin and Elrond to see the project and scalability and the speed.
To be honest, Mihai, I think it's just a matter of time, and they will make the changes at a specific time in the future. We just need to wait and to convince them step by step. You know, there are a lot of providers, a lot of solutions in this space of IoT. A lot of providers are trying to conquer the world and to impose their protocols, their rules, in order to achieve more market share and so on. The key is the adoption and to have, a common protocol, a common background. Very good examples, Mihai, from automotive world. And using blockchain in this kind of examples, for sure, you don't have a corrupted history and everything is more okay from this perspective.
Someone is asking a very techy question about the runtime of Elrond block and if we can scale this down to be almost in real time for example, a communication between Tesla cars in real time. Do you think, I guess we could, but this will decrease the Elrond security and we want that. I don't believe that Elrond is trying to fix the real-time communication for blockchain. I think it's already very fast with 6 seconds, the sweet point of the security, right? But why they should communicate via a blockchain in real time when they could just validate everything after in 6 seconds. Like, they could send in real time everything to a database and after that push every minute or something like that to Elrond or other blockchains, something like that. Is that making sense? Do you think Elrond will try to solve the real time problem as well? Like going
for sure,
to...
for sure. No, for sure not. And we don't need to be crazy. We need to think, okay, we have security, we have IoT, and we have blockchain. We need to think specifically what specific use cases we can use for blockchain. It's like asking, hey, why you don't use TCP instead of UDP, right? TCP is a very reliable protocol. You cannot use for all the use cases. That's why for a fast communication, you're using UDP, right? You can lose some frames and so on. We cannot use blockchain for all the use cases in the high tech. So for sure, this is not a good use case, and we should keep let's say this mix of blockchain and IoT only for let's say security, supply chain, and logistics problems. From my perspective,
do you think in future, I don't know, few years, 2 years, let's say, second layer for Elrond will be live with super speed, considering that we already have 6 seconds. I don't know, someone will build something on top of Elrond to use this security element and the latency and drop the latency to less than a second, for example, as other competitors of layer one are trying to marketing. So something like Matic for Ethereum, but at real scale on Elrond. So at that point, they could use this version of Elrond layer 2 to do everything in real time. But in the end of the day, that layer 2 will send everything to the layer 1, which is blockchain, right? Which is Elrond. So that could work as a solution for this. But
yeah, that's a good approach.
But
that can be happening. And this will require time. There are different partnerships. Also, our CTO groups in Belgium are studying different, let's say, security mechanisms from the blockchain side. We are discussing also here about Elrond as well, and we studied a lot the deep dive protocol of the Elrond side. And I think, as I told you, it's just a matter of time. But we need to have enough time for everything to be settled down. It's a lot of politics, a lot of money involved in all these solutions, and we need to take the time and to have all these discussions. We cannot change the world in 1 day or 1 year, but
less than a year. Let's say less than a year. The mainnet was is not a year.
If every company, let's say, will be capable to execute as Elrond style. The things will be a bit different, but right now, you know, big companies are big dinosaurs, so they need a lot of resources, a lot of time to execute.
Yeah, someone is asking something about cars, that the car parts could also be stored in blockchain, so you don't have like fake a fake door, or after an accident you have fake elements, you know. Like building the entire car in a smart contract and store all components in that smart contract. That sounds like a future plan, but I can see this in the retail as well, like delivery on blockchain and everything to be transparent. There are some companies, I'm not going to give names, which they are still asking for privacy, and we have some partners building this layer of privacy. So people should understand that big businesses, they still need a bit of privacy on top. Why I'm saying that is because competition on the market. Like, a company will create a store. They shouldn't be transparent about what's the volume of their store, right? Because that will influence the stock market. So they
Correct.
Need that layer of security and privacy where people could send the transaction to buy the items, but the customers or the competition will never know that behind that smart contract is company X or something. So I feel like when Elrond will have that live, the privacy layer built by, I think it's Dask, if I'm not wrong, and Hopper, and I think it's one more. That will be amazing. I think at that point we can do a really good marketing to other corporation about, hey, you can implement this, you will have the speed. That's what they are looking for: high speed, low cost, and yeah, and privacy. We also have a, another question I'm reading right now. Is it also possible to store binary data like images on Elrond? And if not, what would be a good solution to not have an image server as a single point of failure?
Yeah, that's a good question. Hi, you know, the blue. You could, but it depends by the size of the files. Blockchain was not designed initially for big files. It was not designed as a cloud, let's say, storage service. More like for security stuff. Usually I have different customers or stuff asking similar questions to me. Usually here I recommend just to keep, let's say, the hashes of the files into the blockchain, just to keep tracking of the hashes to see if something was corrupted or not in your local storage. But for big files, it's possible if you have really, let's say, good resources on your end nodes from the blockchain.
Yeah, I feel that in future we see some, for example, there is another partner, I think it's called Blazor or Bluzer, not sure, which is building on Elrond. A long time ago, I saw that news. They are doing like a database design concept on top of blockchains. Not sure how you'll be able to store there. It's kind of like Filecoin. Not sure how is that working, but this will be on top of Elrond. So that will be interesting. So you'll have database tables, and I guess that's a good start for dApps, like to don't use Oracle database or I don't know, Amazon database. Not sure if I'm allowed to say that, but yeah, you could use really a blockchain native database, and that will be a game changer, I guess. I think this question with the image is referring to probably NFTs, which I get the point of having the NFT like really, really native, because right now the NFT can be just copied from that link and that's all, like they can copy the image. I think I understand his point of view. Let's see other questions from the chat. I saw that Visa have 1,700 transactions per second with 3.3 billion users. Is it a fair comparison? And if not, why is this different? I am not sure about what comparison are you referring to, but if you are asking if Elrond could handle that, the answer is yes, even 10 times more. But I believe that Visa is very expensive to process all the data and is not in real time. So I can give you an example with Revolut again. When you do a top up on Revolut from your bank, your money are visible in Revolut, but Revolut is not receiving that money from my initial bank in less than 3 days, right? So they are just trusting each other that, hey, I will send you this money soon or later, right? Just add, just change the amount in my Revolut account to be ready to spend some money. And you can see the effect of this on the exchanges or Robinhood in America. You know, when it was the meme crazy week when people just deposit and withdraw money, the exchanges and the Robinhood platform had to stop everything because they ran out of real money. Like the money were not that fast to arrive in their account in order to pay people back. So it was very, very crazy. Let me see if we have other questions. We have an explanation from Kevin about the 3.3 billion users needed. If you are asking if we need that many users to do the number of transactions, Probably not. I mean, on Visa, you cannot build softwares, right? That's specifically just for transactions from a
Right.
shop to another shop. So probably on Elrond, you can do that with just 1 million users, active users, and few important services running on the blockchain. So you shouldn't put in comparison the number of users with the number of transactions. Like, yeah, shouldn't work like that really.
Yeah, good questions, guys.
We have something
What is
from
the
Petrica about explaining Mire being the next safe thing after Ledger, even if it's a software wallet on the mobile. Do you think Mire is secure? What do you think?
extremely secure, and from my perspective, right now with this extremely cool feature with the Wallet Connect, I think we can remove Ledger from our life if you want. So yeah, it's pretty secure. And maybe if we want to couple on the long term this one with secure element from the Samsung mobile phones, will be even more secure. Everything and every time, if you can couple a small security software piece with a hardware security a device, you have the perfect mix. So yeah, right now Mire is pretty cool, and I really love that Connect Wallet feature. If will be possible, and I already discussed with the team, if will be possible in the next versions to have even more private keys ready to be saved in into the Mire will be even cooler. I mean, when you try to scan a QR code, okay, to be asking you, okay, for what private key from the Mire I want to open a new channel securely. And in this way, basically, it will be exactly as the Ledger. You can save different private keys into the Mire. Right now, it's possible for only one wallet, which
There is also something. I think we lost Marius. I'm not sure. His Discord is not running. Oh, Marius, are you back? I think you are.
yeah, I am back.
Yeah, you had a crash. Yeah. Do you know the Samsung partnership with Elrond? I am just
Yeah.
talking loud. It's not going to happen. There is no announcement. But I believe that after they implement in Samsung devices a secure element using Knox, you know, they already have Knox and they
Yeah,
already
yeah, yeah,
have.
yeah, yeah.
They are like a Ledger but on your phone. I believe that
Exactly. It's a more secure element.
Mire will be able to communicate somehow with that secure element from Ledger, and at that point will be even more secure than is now, right?
Yeah. Knox is basically, if you want a secure element, a trust OS. There are different in this space of IoT. Knox is basically a very secure software links operating systems, which is running directly on the secure element of the Samsung. For sure, we can have here different applications, or we can couple the secure storage of the Mire directly to the secure storage of the Samsung.
We have
It's
a
really
question
no problem.
from Istari, a very interesting question. Is it possible to implement blockchain technology on existing chipsets that are used in IoT or cars? If yes, how?
This is a very, very good question.
Do you think it's
And
just a software update or something like that, firewall? I don't know.
yeah, in this moment, we study a lot this blockchain phenomenon, and we study a lot different blockchain protocols. And to be honest with you, Mihai, there are very, very less which are basically correctly implemented from both security and safety perspective. This is one. Second, it's a problem of size. You know, in embedded and these kind of IoT devices, the flash size are very important. So we should have, if you want, all the blockchain for a specific algorithm only in C or something very very flexible after you build that program to have a very small footprint of it. So this is second. But what is the most important is the scalability of that blockchain. So if you are trying to use right now the blockchain of the Ethereum, of the Bitcoin or other blockchains, for sure these are not scalable enough for all these IoT devices. We are discussing right now in this context about millions of devices that will need to operate together in the same time. So we need to support millions of transactions per second. So a huge TPS. And right now there are very, very less blockchains and protocols capable for that that stream. Elrond is capable to scale using, from my calculations, like 400 shards will be capable to scale to millions of TPS. And it's very cool. With some changes to have a smaller footprint, will be capable to incorporate this technology in the current chips. Should be real, no problem. What is also very interesting with Elrond is not even capable to scale, but he can scale linearly, and this is very fascinating. What is about scaling linearly? What having a very small latency? It's basically the capacity of the systems to take different actions when the system is changing, and this is very important. For example, right now, if you have only 1 million transactions, and I don't know, after 1 minute you have 10 million transactions, if you can open a lot of shards in order to accommodate all these new transactions in a very quick manner, this is about a low latency and very good linear scalability.
We have a question for you from Eddie from Valid Blocks. What's the coolest IoT implementation on blockchain? What do you think will be?
The coolest IoT implementation on blockchain, from my perspective, are two right now. The first one is the one we discussed already, the secure over there update. In order to be sure that every secure package is encrypted correctly for a specific chip, and that chip is a legitimate chip, not a clone one. So this will be one. So this one will improve a lot the handshake between the client and the server, and will be very trustable. And the second one, I think, is the what we are calling secure and smart driving. You know, a lot of cars will be self-driving, and they will need to take actions and to route the best route for you and so on. For sure, these decisions need to be implemented using blockchain in order to take the best one and the most trustable one, and to not have, let's say, bad actors in these systems trying to hack the traffic or to hack the cars and so on. So in my opinion, these two, the secure over there update and the secure traffic, will be the most important.
Yeah. Also, there are unlimited IoT inventions you can build. They just need to accept the blockchain that it's here to stay, and they need to start to build on this technology as quick as they can. Another question.
Not just a small idea here. Another cool feature will be, imagine what will be possible to pay, let's say, any car fees automatically, let's say for the highway or something, to not stop the car. Just paying automatically, the car will take action for you to pay with crypto, and that's it, transparently for you. You just have in Meyer a push notification. Okay, I paid for you this highway pass.
Imagine registering your car in Meyer as a. Actually, you could do that because Elrond is supporting the storage at the account level. You know, you could register the registration number. I don't know, everything you want in that. So digital identity. Should we touch a bit on this?
And you put a QR code on the car, and that's it. It will be scanned. And
Should we touch the digital identity and how the security by default offered by blockchain will handle this, like passport, country IDs, all this stuff which are very old school right now, like they give you a plastic, you know. So there is a funny story in my city in Romania. They ran out of plastic, so they weren't able to print the ID, like new IDs, for like 3 months. Imagine that, because they were waiting for plastic cards. That's crazy. Yeah, so how do you think this will work in the digital identity?
For sure it will work a lot. And yeah, we have enough space to improve here. Blockchain is a disruptive technology, and for sure is enough space to improve these things. Yeah, it's just a matter of time, and for sure be adopted.
We also need scalability for this, because you know how many people are traveling daily. Like, I think millions are moving around the world in airports per day, or even faster than per day. So if they will scan the ID in the same time, they will do a transaction to the blockchain. So they need to scale this. As well, for this scalability, I think they need privacy for this identity, digital identity, because not everyone should access your data. I don't know. You know, you should be privacy about your age, about your address, and all this. So I believe this will be a mix between decentralized and centralized exchange, not exchanges, like corporation or governments. Like, the governments will control the data, but you sign when to unlock the data for them to see you, you know. This one shouldn't be public on the blockchain directly. Should have some layers of privacy, right?
Yeah, I am totally agree with that. The ownership of the data should be private.
Another question. Why is all data stored in hexadecimal on the blockchain? Interesting. I don't really know for this. I mean, you could store in any type, but I believe it's easy to understand it at the smart contract level in hex. You know,
technically speaking, everything is binary based. Hex decimal is just a matter how we decided to show those data. We can have we can improve this, and I think the question is more related to Explorer showing data. We can improve this one and having, let's say, decoded by default in ASCII or something. It's, let's say, the more popular raw information we are depicting right now on the Explorer side.
We could handle this at the UI layer and leave the blockchain alone, storing in hex, you know. Like, we're already doing this in Mire, with the, you know, the data of the transaction. Sometimes it's translated from hex, and it's saying, hey, you actually withdraw this money from this staking provider.
Correct.
Yeah, so I think this can be handled very easily. Something else, let me read through the chat. Is there any book for Elrond that exists for BTC or Ethereum, like Mastering Bitcoin, to better understand Elrond on a technical level? Well, considering that Elrond is less than a year old, everything is moving very fast, like many updates. The framework, it's updating every week or even faster. Our team is very fast at building code. So no one will have time right now to write a book about Elrond, because if they start to write the book now with what's today, when this guy will finish the book, what was today is not going to be the same. So the book will be wrong. So I believe in a few years, when everything will be stable and the protocol will require less interaction, not that many
updates.
And very, let's say, break changes, updates, like something which is not like before. At that point, someone could start to write a book. And I believe the best person to write a book will be someone from Elrond team, which really understand everything on all layers, you know.
Yeah, totally agree.
The guy who asked about the hexadecimal is asking, it's saying that yes, on the Explorer, but also if I want to create an NFT, I have to convert everything to hexa and other erupt commands.
And this is just a matter of time. Everything will be updated.
You will get used to with that, probably.
Yes, and we have also a very nice GUI and UI on the that side directly from the wallet. As we have right now for creating a new token, ESDT token on the testnet wallet, for example.
Yeah.
So everything will be more user friendly from UI perspective, also on the mainnet.
Even from CDK, probably you will see in the future updates that will be some builder's method, like give me a name, give me a URL, and I will convert everything to hexa for you, and don't worry about all this. But as we said, everything is in progress. Updates are there every week, even daily almost. So yeah, just wait a bit. I don't think we have any more questions. So let's wait probably 2 minutes, see if some people are asking something new.
Okay, I will double check also my groups and my telegrams.
So, something from Vlad G. Elrond is the perfect match even to the Amazon Go shops, guys. Yeah, I can agree with you. Elrond, it's a perfect match, and yeah. Who knows? Maybe one day. We'll be there.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay, so we discussed pretty a lot about IoT, security, and all this blockchain. Yeah, what is really nice about Elrond, it's really capable right now to push the adoption also to the IoT space, because it's really scalable in a linear way, and this is critical. This is very, very important. Without linear scalability, you cannot have any kind of adoption to the blockchain side. Also, very small fees, and this also is a very important topic. We cannot have huge fees when we are discussing about millions of TPS. And also, a very important topic is composability of the smart contracts. It's, let's say, a very more deep dive technical information, but composability between shards also is very, very important to keep, let's say, the information reliable and trustable when you are discussing about parallelism between different shards, and we are discussing about transaction from a shard to another when we have smart contracts in different locations. So this one also is very important. All these three characteristics are very important in order to have a blockchain adopted to the IoT mass market.
Cool, Marius. I think we are done. I don't see new questions. Everyone seems happy. Hopefully, we shared a lot of knowledge with our community. I really enjoyed this chat with you. Even we talk pretty often about these subjects between us, but happy to share everything. I see that you, Mihai, Benny, Luci are wearing that black ring. It's a payment device. Are we more deep into... no, guys, that's not a payment device. It could be. You could do a feedback for the company, but it's just a healthy tracker. But I like your observation skill.
Also, I want to thank you, Mihai, for this opportunity, and I want to thank you to the Elrond team officially. These guys are amazing, and they help us a lot. I want to say a big thank you to our validator groups and to those staking provider groups and group members. Big great to be together in this story. And also, I want to say a big thank you and best regards to my community, to the ABG staking community members. And to my team, of course, I want to salute here Patrick, Costi, Tortuga, Andre, Eddie, all the guys there. You guys are rocking, and thank you for the support.
Cool, guys. Thank you for attending to our Elrond Talks episode 5, and be ready for the episode 6 next week. We don't really know yet who will be streaming that one, but for sure we will distribute the news everywhere across all providers, and everyone will know the topic with some days before. Bye guys, have a great night and see you soon.